Hare Krishna, I welcome you all today. Today we will be beginning the first chapter of seventh canto, namely the Supreme Lord is equal to everyone. So let us recite the Mangalacharan prayers first. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Iti Namine नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वागीशा यस्य वदने लक्ष्मीर यस्य च वक्षसि यस्य ते हृदये संवित् तं नृसिंहमहं भजे एकेन चक्रम परेण करेण शंखम अन्येन सिन्धुतनयम् अवलम्ब्य तिष्ठन् वामेतरेण वरदाभय पद्मचिह्नम् लक्ष्मी नृसिंह मम देहि करावलम्बम् उग्रं वीरं महाविष्णुं ज्वलन्तं सर्वतो मुखं नृसिंहं भीषणं भद्रं मृत्युं मृत्योर्नमाम्यहम् प्रह्लाद नारद पराशर पुण्डरीका व्यासादि भगवत पुंगव हृन्निवासा भक्तानुरुक्त परिपालन पारिजाता लक्ष्मी नृसिंह मम देहि करावलंबम पादौ यदीयौ प्रथमा द्वितीयौ तृतीय तुर्यस्कतितौ यदूरु नाभिस्तदा पंचम एव षष्ठो भुजान्तरं दोर्युगलं ततोऽन्यतु कंठस्तु राजन्नवमो यदीयो मुखारविन्दं दशमं प्रफुल्लं एकादशौ यस्य ललाटपत्तं शिरोऽपि तु द्वादश एव वाति तमादिदेवं करुणानिधानं तमालवर्णं सुहितावतारम् अपार संसार समुद्र सेतुं भजामहे भागवत स्वरूपं भजामहे भागवत स्वरूपं ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे मूकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्री गुरुं दीनतारिणां हरे कृष्णा सो वेलकम यू ऑल वंस अगेन today we'll be beginning the seventh canto. Yesterday, one of you had requested for an overview of Srimad Bhagavatam. So, we have put this PowerPoint presentation, we have put this slide in the PPT for that purpose. So, the verse which we recited sometime back, Padau yadiyo, prathama dvitiyo, tritiya turiyo, katitau yaduru, navishtadapan chama eva sashto, Bhujantaram dor yugalam tatanyau. So, the first two cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam are compared to the lotus feet of the Lord. The third and the fourth cantos are compared to the thighs of the Lord. The fifth canto is compared to the navel of the Lord. Nabish tatapan chama eva sashtau. The sixth canto is compared to the chest of the Lord. The seventh canto compared to the arms of the Lord. The seventh and the eighth cantos. The ninth canto is compared to throat of the Lord, Kantastu Rajan Navamo Yadiyo, Mukharavindam Dashamam Prapullam. The 10th canto is compared to the lotus face of the Lord. The 11th canto to the forehead and 12th canto is compared to the head of the Lord. So this is a verse, a very famous verse from Padma Puran. So that is the overview of Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, today we will be beginning the seventh canto. Yesterday we had discussed the purpose of the specific purpose of reciting or studying seventh canto, because the seventh canto mainly deals with the pastime of Lord Narasimhadev, who incarnated with a specific purpose to remove the obstacles in the path of devotional service of his devotee Prahlad. So let us begin with the first verse today. Sri Raja Uvacha Samapriya Suhrid Brahman Bhutanam Bhagavan Swayam Indrasyarte Katam Daityan Avadit Vishamo Yatha. King Parikshit Maharaj inquired from Sukadeva Goswami as follows. My dear Brahmana, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, being everyone's well-wisher, is equal and extremely dear to everyone. How then did he become partial like a common man for the sake of Indra and thus kill Indra's enemies? How can a person equal to everyone be partial to some and inimical towards others? So this is a very relevant question. We have seen Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam actually is manifested when there are two great personalities. One is the speaker and another is the hearer. Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken on many occasions. One such occasion was when Sukadeva Goswami was actually speaking to Parikshit Maharaj. So this is a very relevant inquiry. The other occasions are when Suta Goswami speaks to the sages of Naimisharanya. Similarly, Brahma spoke this to Narada. So the context here is Parikshit Maharaj is actually inquiring from Suta Goswami. How come the Supreme Lord Vishnu, who is everyone's well-wisher and who is equal and extremely dear to everyone, how did he become partial like a common man for the sake of Indra? Who is Indra? Indra is the king of the demigods. How come he became partial like a common man for the sake of Indra and thus killed Indra's enemies? What is the reason for this? How can a person like the Supreme Lord, who is equal to everyone, be partial to some and inimical to others? So this is a very relevant question, because it appears sometimes that Lord is partial. Many of us may think like, why did God do this to me? After all, I have done so many things in my life. And a kind of question may come within all of us. It may appear that Lord is favoring certain people more than others. Why is this? Why does it appear like that? How can a person who is equal, who is the well-wisher of everyone, who is equal to everyone, and who is extremely dear to everyone, how did he become partial? Nahyashyarta suraganai sakshan nishreyasatmata sakshan nishreyasatmanaha naiva surebhyo vidvesho nodvegas chagunasyahi. Lord Vishnu, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is the reservoir of all pleasure. Therefore, what benefit would he derive from siding with the demigods? What interest would he fulfill in this way? Since the Lord is transcendental, why should he fear the asuras? And how could he be envious of them? So King Parikshit, Maharaj Parikshit is taking the position of a common man to whom it looks as if Lord is impartial. So Parikshit Maharaj is asking a very relevant question here. Ite nasu mahabhaga Narayana gunan prati samshayasu mahan jatas tadbhavam chetum arhati. Oh, greatly fortunate and learned Brahmana, whether Narayana is partial or impartial has become a subject of great doubt. Kindly dispel my doubt with positive evidence that Narayana is always neutral and equal to everyone. So this is a very beautiful attitude, which is actually displayed by Parikshit Maharaj. How he is inquiring the spiritual master. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said, in order for one to receive transcendental knowledge, one must approach a bona fide spiritual master. And one must humbly inquire from the bona fide spiritual master. One must serve the spiritual master. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Upadekshyanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinaha. So here we see Parikshit Maharaj actually is convinced. He knows that Narayana or the Supreme Lord or Vishnu, who is always extremely dear to everyone, who is always the well-wisher of everyone. He knows that Narayana is neutral, but he wants to dispel this subject matter because many of us, many of the conditioned souls feel that Lord has become partial despite he being the supreme well-wisher of everyone. So he wanted to dispel this doubt in everyone's mind. So that is the reason, on behalf of the conditioned soul, Parikshit Maharaj, with great humility, was putting forth this question to a great personality like Sukadeva Goswami, who is the spiritual master. Sri Rishiru Vacha Sadhu Prishtam Maharaja Haresh Charitam Adbhutam Yad Bhagavata Mahatmyam Bhagavad Bhakti Vardhanam. The great sage Sukadeva Goswami said, "My dear king, you have put before me an excellent question. Discourses concerning the activities of the Lord, in which the glories of his devotees are also found, are extremely pleasing to devotees. Such wonderful topics always counteract the miseries of the materialistic way of life. Therefore, great sages like Narada always speak upon Srimad Bhagavatam because it gives one the facility to hear and chant about the wonderful activities of the Lord. Let me offer my respectful obeisances unto Srila Vyasadeva and then begin describing topics concerning the activities of Lord Hari." So Narada Muni says that the discourses concerning the activities of the Lord. Sadhu Prishtam Maharaja Haresh Charitam Adbhutam. Discourses related to the activities of the Lord in which the glories of his devotees are also found. Example is Srimad Bhagavatam. Are extremely pleasing to devotees, and those topics always counteract the miseries of the materialistic way of life. So that is the reason we are actually discussing Srimad Bhagavatam, because these discourses, these discussions which describe the activities of the Lord in relation with his devotees, in which the glories of the Lord, the glories of devotees and glories of devotional service is explained. Such topics always counteract the miseries of the materialistic way of life. As we had been discussing yesterday, discussing of Srimad Bhagavatam, studying Srimad Bhagavatam is the beginning process. Shravanam Kirtanam is the beginning process of worshipping the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, Sri Narasimhadev or Sri Vishnu. Why should one worship the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord? Worshipping the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord is the only way to become fearless. It is the only way in which the miseries of the materialistic way of life can be mitigated. Srinvatam Svakatha Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana Hridayantasyo Hyabhadrani Vidhunoti Suhritsatam Nashtaprayeshu Vapadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavat Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki. So those verses are described in the first canto. You can refer to them. How discussing the glories of the Supreme Lord in relation to his devotees, how they actually elevate one to the highest platform of devotional service gradually. It is described in the first canto in the beginning chapters. Giyate paramam punyam rishibhir naradadibhi natva krishnaya munaye katayishye hare katham. So Sukadeva Goswami says here, "My dear king, you have put before me an excellent question." See, the spiritual master is very much pleased. This is the foundational principle of spiritual life. One must humbly approach a spiritual master with an attitude not of challenging, not an attitude of challenging the spiritual master, but with an attitude of service and humble inquiry. Tatviddhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevya. It is described in Bhagavad Gita 4th chapter. My dear king, so the spiritual master is very pleased here. Sukadeva Goswami is very happy with the question. Discourses concerning the activities of the Lord in which the glories of his devotees are also found are extremely pleasing to devotees. Such wonderful topics always contract the miseries of materialistic way of life. Therefore, great sages like Narada always speak about Srimad Bhagavatam. Let me offer my respectful obeisances unto Srila Vyasadeva and then begin describing the topics concerning the activities of Lord Hari. So we are all very, very fortunate that we have an opportunity to come together every day to glorify the Supreme Lord. No doubt, it's a great blessing of the Supreme Lord. It's a great mercy of the Supreme Lord upon all of us that we are getting the inspiration to dedicate some time to discuss the glories of the Lord. And I thank each and every one of you. Let us begin. Nirgunopihyajo vyakto bhagavan prakrite paraha samaya gunam avishya vadya badakatam gataha. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, is always transcendental to the material qualities, and therefore he is called Nirguna or without qualities. Because he is unborn, he does not have a material body to be subjected to attachment and hatred. Although the Lord is always above material existence, through his spiritual potency, he appeared and acted as an ordinary human being, accepting duties and obligations, apparently like a conditioned soul. It's a very important understanding. Sukadeva Goswami replies, the Supreme Lord Vishnu, he is always transcendental to material qualities, and therefore he is called Nirguna. So many people generally say that Lord doesn't have any qualities. The Lord doesn't have any form when they hear that Lord is Nirguna. But Nirguna does not mean without qualities. Nirguna means without material qualities. Nirguna means one who is having completely transcendental qualities. Because he is unborn. Bhagavan prakrite para swamaya gunam avishya badya vadakatam gataha. Because he is unborn, he does not have a material body. He is not born like us. Because he is the cause of all causes. So here, when we have to understand how the Lord is dealing, one must be very clear of who God is, of who Krishna is, who Vishnu is, and who we are. So the question here is that it appears as though Lord is partial, although he is the supreme well-wisher of everyone. So one must understand here a very important point. What is the difference between a conditioned soul and Supreme Lord? So here Shukadeva Goswami is explaining. Supreme Lord is always transcendental to the material qualities. Therefore, he is called Nirguna or without qualities. Without qualities means without material qualities. Because he is unborn. Why is he unborn? Because he is the cause of all causes. Ishvara Paramakrishna Sachidananda Vigraha Anadiradir Govinda Sarvakarana Karanam. He is the cause of all causes. He is the unborn. He does not have a material body to be subjected to attachment and hatred. Although the Lord is always above material existence, through his spiritual potency, he appeared and acted as an ordinary human being. So firstly, one must understand the position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When it appears that Lord is dealing in a particular way, we must understand. See, some people may complain that Lord is partial. Lord is doing like this, Lord is doing like this, Lord is wrong this time. No, Lord is never like that. So in order to understand how the Lord is actually, how the Lord is reciprocating or how the Lord is dealing, one must actually understand who is the Lord. So here the explanation is given. What is the difference between conditioned soul and Lord? Conditioned soul has material qualities. Conditioned soul is born. He undergoes the cycle of birth and death. He has a material body, and because he has a material body, he is subjected to attachment and hatred. So the difference between Supreme Lord and the conditioned soul is that the living entity is a part and parcel of Krishna. And the Lord is the Supreme. Mame Vamsho Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatana Manashashtan Indriyani Prakriti Sthani Karshati. So the living entity is a part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. And the Lord has supreme independence and the living entity has minute independence. Because the living entity also has minute independence, when he misuses his independence, he is actually put into material existence where the three gunas or the three modes of material nature control him. And what is the result of that? The result of that is he is subjected to attachment and hatred. Attachment towards what he likes or what he feels is good, and hatred towards something which is not very much favorable to him. So the context of discussion is that Supreme Lord, he appears partial. When is a living entity, a conditioned living entity is definitely partial. Yes. How can we say this? Yes. To people who always flatter us, who always conduct themselves according to our likes and desires, to them, towards them, we are very favorably disposed. We treat them very nicely, right? And we always reciprocate very nicely with them. And to people who are little rebellious of us, how is our behavior? Our behavior is totally the opposite. We try to avoid them. We try to, somehow or the other, we don't treat them properly. That means we have attachment towards something which gives us happiness, and we have aversion or we have hatred towards something which actually does not give us happiness, or to be specific, we have hatred towards something which actually hurts us. But the Lord is not like that. This attachment and hatred which we have is because the conditioned soul, all of us, we are actually under the three modes of material nature in the material existence. As a result, we have this Icha and Dvesha. Icha Dvesha Samuttena Dvandva Mohena Bharata. So this is described in Bhagavad Gita. But what is the position of the Supreme Lord? The position of living entity is, the position of conditioned living entity is that he is subjected to the three modes, as a result of which he has attachment and hatred. But the position of Supreme Lord is not like that. Supreme Lord is always transcendental to the material qualities. So therefore, this attachment, this material attachment and material hatred which we have is not there in the Supreme Lord. So therefore, the Lord is always above the material existence through his spiritual potency. And he appears and acts like an ordinary human being, accepting duties and obligations apparently like a conditioned soul. So the Lord coming down to the material existence, although he is always above the material existence and acting like an ordinary human being, accepting duties and obligations, is actually a manifestation of his mercy. Sattvam rajastam iti prakriter natmano guna natesham yugapat rajan rasha ullasa evava. My dear King Parikshit, the material qualities, Sukadeva Goswami is explaining here. He explained that Lord is above the material. The Lord is completely transcendental to the material qualities. Now he is explaining the material qualities, sattva guna, rajo guna, and tamo guna. Sattvam rajastama iti prakriter natmano guna. All these three material qualities belong to the material world, and they do not even touch the Supreme Personality of Godhead. You can see the difference here in the picture. The picture is not complete, I think. The conditioned soul, or maybe I'll just show this picture. There is Bhagavad Gita here. Is everyone able to see this picture? Can someone just respond?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes. So here we see the two conditioned souls are fighting, right?
A little bit up, so little bit higher.
Just bit up.
A little bit higher, Prabhu. You can't see the. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay now?
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. So here we see the two conditioned souls are fighting amongst themselves. They are fighting between themselves. But actually, their actions are conducted by the three gunas, the sattva guna, rajo guna, and tamo guna, just like puppets. So therefore, they are puppets under the three gunas. When a conditioned soul, who is rebellious of the Supreme Lord, is put into this material existence, then he comes under these three gunas, sattva guna, tamo guna, rajo guna, and tamo guna. As a result, all his activities are conducted by the three gunas, because of which he has attachment and hatred, because of which he is partial. He is partial in the sense, he is very favorably disposed to those people who flatter him or who gratify his ego or who gratify his senses. At the same time, he is not very favorably disposed. He is very inimical towards those people who do not gratify his ego or who do not gratify his senses. So because what is the reason a conditioned soul is partial? The reason a conditioned soul is partial is because he is under the influence of the three modes. And Krishna is above the three modes. Maya dhyakshena prakriti suyate sacharacharam hetunanena kaunteya jagat viparivatyate. So Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, his material nature is actually functioning under his supervision, under his adhyaksha. So Krishna, as we see here, what Sukadeva Goswami is saying is, Krishna is above the three modes. These three gunas cannot act, or they cannot even touch the Supreme Lord. Tattva guna, rajo guna, and tamo guna. So the Lord, even if he appears to be partial, what is the reason? We will see in the future verses. But a conditioned soul, Parikshit Maharaj here is actually taking the position of a conditioned soul. Parikshit Maharaj has taken the position of a conditioned soul and he's asking why it appears like this, why is the Lord like this? So Sukadeva Goswami is actually explaining a living entity, a conditioned living entity, his aversion and his attachment is because of the three influence of three qualities, and his being partial is a result of his aversion and attachment, and his aversion and attachment is because he is under the influence of the three gunas. But the Supreme Lord is not under the influence of the three gunas. Then why he appears partial, we will see in the future verses. Jaya kale tu sattvasya devarshin rajaso suran tamaso yaksha rakshamsi tatkala nuguno bhajat. When the quality of goodness is prominent, the sages and demigods flourish with the help of that quality, in which they are infused and surcharged by the Supreme Lord. Similarly, when the mode of passion is prominent, the demons flourish. And when the ignorance is prominent, the yakshas and rakshasas flourish. The Supreme Lord is present in everyone's heart, fostering the reactions of sattva guna, rajo guna, and tamo guna. So what is the position of the Supreme Lord? He is just a witness, and he is present in everyone's heart as the Paramatma, Upadrishtva Anumanta. So what the Supreme Lord does, he fosters the reaction of sattva guna, rajo guna, and tamo guna, and a combination of these three gunas according to the karma of the living entity. So then the quality of goodness is prominent, the sages and demigods flourish. That is the explanation given. Jyotiradiri vabhati sanghatanna vivichyate vidantyatmanam atmastam matitva kavayontata. The all-pervading Supreme Personality of Godhead exists within the heart of every living being. And an expert thinker can perceive how he is present there to a large or small extent. Just as one can understand the supply of fire in the wood, the water in a water pot, or the sky within a pot, one can understand whether a living entity is a demon or a demigod by understanding that living entity's devotional performances. A thoughtful man can understand how much a person is favored by the Supreme Lord. Now, this is a very important point. Sukadeva Goswami is actually describing the position of the Supreme Lord in context of the question asked by Parikshit Maharaj. Parikshit Maharaj's question was, why is the Lord partial? So Sukadeva Goswami is slowly explaining who is God. What is his position? So the all-pervading Supreme Personality of Godhead exists within the heart of every living being. And therefore, An expert thinker can perceive how he is present there to a large or a small extent. Just as one can understand, a thoughtful man can understand how much a person is favored by Supreme Lord by seeing his action. So how much a particular person is favored by the Supreme Lord. We see here, Lord is present in the heart of a sadhu. Lord is present in the heart of the elephant. Lord is present in the heart of a dog also. Lord is present in the heart of a cow. Lord is present in everyone's heart here. But different people, in the sense a thoughtful man can understand how much a person is favored by the Supreme Lord. In order to know how much everyone is favored by the Supreme Lord, one must become thoughtful. Or in other words, only a thoughtful person or only a devotee of the Supreme Lord. We see here, this person is a sadhu, he's a sannyasi, he's a very elevated person. So he can actually understand how much a particular person is favored by Supreme Lord. He is able to understand, see, person in the sense, we say it's a soul actually. The sadhu is able to understand how the Supreme Lord is favoring the elephant. The sadhu is able to understand how the Lord is favoring the dog. He is able to understand everyone's position. So in order to understand how everyone is favored by the Supreme Lord, one has to become thoughtful. Or in other words, only a thoughtful man can understand how much a person is favored by the Supreme Lord. Yada shirkshupura atmanaparo rajas rajatyesha pritak samayaya sattvam vichitrashu niram surishwaraha saisya manastama iryatyashau irayatyashau. When the Supreme Lord creates different types of bodies, offering a particular body to each living entity according to his character and fruitive action, the Lord revives all the qualities of material nature, sattvaguna, rajoguna and tamoguna. Thus, as the super soul, he enters each body and influences the qualities of creation, maintenance and annihilation using sattvaguna for maintenance, rajoguna for creation and tamoguna for annihilation. So, the Supreme Lord is the one who is created this material existence. And when he creates the material, what is the purpose of the Supreme Lord creating? And once he creates the material existence, he also gives different types of bodies to each living entity. In fact, Mother Nature gives the bodies, but Mother Nature is again under the superintendence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as we have seen. Maya Adhyakshena Prakriti Suyate Sacharacharam. So when the Supreme Lord creates different types of bodies, the Supreme Lord creates this whole material manifestation. He creates this whole material world. What is the purpose of creating that material world? The purpose of creating that material world is to facilitate a living entity's free will to enjoy separately from him. That is the purpose of creation of this material world. And once the material world is, because always there are jivas, always there are souls who are rebellious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. We have seen the Supreme Lord and the living entity are eternally related, as the Supreme Lord and the servant. A living entity is always a servant of the Supreme Lord. But some living entities are rebellious because they have their minute independence, they have their minute free will. Some living entities want to use that free will properly and become a servant of the Supreme Lord, whereas there are other living entities who misuse that independence. But every living entity has independence. So Lord is a supreme father of every living entity. He is a very kind father. In order to facilitate, suppose there is a father and there is a small boy, there is a, say, a 3 or 4 year old boy and there is a father. A father is driving a car. So the 3 or 4 year old boy wants to drive the same car. Can he drive the same car? No. Similarly, by the dint of our false ego, the conditioned living entity is always rebellious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So when he is rebellious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, what is the evidence that he is rebellious? He wants to lord over everything. The tendency to lord over everything is a manifestation of his tendency to be envious of the Supreme Lord. He wants to lord over everything. He wants to take God's position. But is it possible for the living entity to take lord's position. Is it possible for a 3-year or 4-year old boy to drive a car which the father is driving? No, it is not possible. Therefore, what does a kind father do? If the child is very adamant, a kind father buys him a toy car so that he can play with it for some time. Similarly, Lord has created this material world and he has given all of us this material body. Why? According to one's character and fruitive actions, according to one's karma. Karmana daiva netrena. So it is described in the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam in Kapila Dev section. Karmana daiva netrena. How actually a living entity takes shelter of the womb of a mother? It is based on his karma under the supervision of the Supreme Lord. So the Supreme Lord creates this material universe and he offers a particular body to a particular living entity based on his previous karma. And then the Lord revives all the qualities of material nature, sattva guna, rajo guna and tamo guna. And then as the super soul, he enters each body. How merciful the Lord is. He enters each body and influences the qualities of creation, maintenance and annihilation. Because the living entity desires it. Because there is karma. Because there is desire. So therefore, a living entity has to act under these gunas. So he influences the qualities of creation, maintenance and annihilation based on the guna and karma of the living entity. Sattva guna for maintenance, rajo guna for creation and tamo guna for annihilation. Kalam charantam trijati shashrayam pradhana pupyam naradeva satyakrit. O King, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the controller of the material and spiritual energies, who is certainly the creator of the entire cosmos, creates the time factor to allow the material energy and the living entity to act within the limits of time. Thus, the Supreme Lord is never under the time factor or under the material energy. So, in response to Parikshit Maharaj's question, why the Supreme Lord appears partial? Sukadev Goswami is actually describing the difference between the Supreme Lord and the conditioned living entity. Supreme Lord, what we have seen, he is above the three modes, whereas the conditioned living entity is under the influence of three modes. Similarly, the Supreme Lord is completely independent. And he is the one who creates different types of bodies to a living entity. And the Supreme Lord is the controller of material and spiritual energies. He is the creator of this entire material universe, the entire cosmic manifestation. And he is the creator of the time factor that allows the material energy and the living entity to act within the limits of time. So the conditioned soul is under the influence of three modes. And he is under the influence of time. He is under the influence of karma. Whereas the Supreme Lord, he is the creator of the material world. He is the creator of the time factor. And he is not under the influence of the mode. He is neither under the influence of time factor nor under the influence of material energy. So this is the distinction between a conditioned soul and a Supreme Lord. So in order to understand why Supreme Lord is behaving in a certain way or why Supreme Lord is acting in a certain way, one must first understand who is the Supreme Lord. One must not superimpose our thought process on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Our thought process, what is our thought process? Our thought process is we are always under the influence of three modes and as a result of which we are always partial. How come we are partial? We are partial because we have Icha and Dvesha because of attachment and aversion. We have Icha or we have attachment to things which gratify our ego. And we have aversion towards something which actually hurts our ego or which does, hurts our ego and which flatters our ego. So this Icha and Dvesha are there in a living entity, but the Lord is not like that. So what is the distinction? What is the difference between the conditioned soul and Supreme Lord is being illustrated by Sukadev Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj. Yaesha Rajan Apikala Ishita Sattvam Surani Kamivai Dayatyata tat pratyanikan asuran surapriyo rajas tamaskan praminot yurushrava. He says, Sukadeva Goswami says, O Parikshit Maharaj, O King, this time factor enhances the sattva guna. Thus, although the Supreme Lord is the controller, he favors the demigods who are mostly situated in sattva guna. Then the demons who are influenced by tamo guna are annihilated. The Supreme Lord induces the time factor to act in different ways, but he is never partial. Rather, his activities are all glorious, and therefore he is called Urushrava. Rajas tamaskan praminotyurushrava. So here he says, Lord is the creator of the time factor, which we have seen. And the time factor enhances the sattva guna. We have seen previous slides. When the good quality of goodness is prominent, the sages and demigods flourish with the help of that quality. And similarly, when the mode of passion is prominent, the demons flourish. So with the influence of time, the sattva guna is enhanced. Whereas the rajoguna and tamoguna, they are actually annihilated. So it is the influence of the time factor. Lord creates the time factor. But as a result of the time factor, every person acts in a different way. So there is an explanation given to this in the future verses. The explanation given is, the Supreme Lord, he is the Supreme Father of every living entity. Can a father, say for example, a father is there and there are two children. The father has two sons, for example. There is one son who is very obedient to the father and who abides by the traditions of the family, who does his duty very responsibly. And there is another son who is just the opposite. Now, if someone asks a question, is not the father partial to the first son? Can there be a situation when a father loves one son more than the other? There can never be a situation. A father is always, a father loves all his children or all his sons equally. But sometimes a particular behavior or a particular nature of a child makes a father more inclined towards one child or one son, and a particular nature of another child, it appears that the father is not very favorable to him, but it only appears. I'm just giving an analogy here. I'm just giving an analogy to understand. So therefore, after all, father is also a person, right? Father is also a person. So he also has feelings. When you say he's a person, he has feelings. He has a form. He has some qualities. He has feelings. So therefore, although he is kind to both the sons, to one son who is very favorable, automatically he is favorably disposed. Is it the fault of the father? No. And just because he is favorably disposed to one son, it does not mean that he is inimical, or it does not mean that he is grudgeful, or it does not mean that he is, he is unfavorable to the other son. No. It is the son's conduct with which the father reciprocates. If a son is conducting himself very favorably, after all, even father is a person. Similarly, you know, there are three gunas, and this time factor enhances the sattva guna. And what is the nature of sattva guna? It is described in Bhagavad Gita. So sattva guna brings one to a more and more pious and religious platform, and gradually, when one comes to sattva guna, he can actually transcend the three modes also. In order to transcend the three modes, one must come to sattva guna. So the activities in sattva guna, the conduct of a person in sattva guna is very favorable to the Supreme Lord. In the sense, a person who is predominantly in sattva guna, his activities and his consciousness and his thought process, it is very favorable to the Supreme Lord and devotion. And to those persons who are influenced by tamoguna and rajoguna, their activities are not very favorable. Now, there are some persons who are enhanced and time factor. And time factor is something which actually induces these different people in different gunas to act in a particular way. So, Lord only creates the time factor, but he is never, he only creates the time factor. And because of the time factor, somebody who is in sattva guna and who enhances in sattva guna, his conduct is very favorable to the Supreme Lord. And slowly it appears that Lord is more inclined to him. Definitely Lord is a person, why should he not be inclined? But it only appears his inclination or his inclination to a particular set of people, even though they are in sattva guna, is not like our partiality. This is what is the point which is explained here. When we are partial, it is because of the influence of three modes on us, because of which we have attachment and aversion. But if Lord is, if it appears that Lord is favoring some people, it is not the influence of three modes on the Supreme Lord. Because the Lord is not under the influence of three modes, he is completely transcendental to the three modes, and he is like a supreme kind father who is little favorable or who is little inclined to those children who are favorable to him, which is very natural. It does not mean that when we are partial, it is very evident that we are favorable and we are inimical. And because of our partiality, nobody benefits actually. Even the people to whom we are very favorable, they also don't benefit because our whole purpose is material in that partiality. But when the Lord is partial, when he is favorably disposed to a particular set of people, and when it looks that he is not, when it appears that he is not, actually he is favorably, I mean, when it appears that he is not favorably disposed to another set of people, both of them are benefited. You will see how it is in the future verses. So the Supreme Lord doesn't do anything here. He is not partial. He just induces the time factor. Because of the time factor, different living entities who are influenced by different gunas, they act in different ways by which Lord favors them or conducts with them differently. But the Lord's activities are glorious. We'll discuss for 5 more minutes and then we'll take questions. अत्रैवोदाहृतः पूर्वम् इतिहासस्सुरार्षिणा प्रीत्या महाकृतौ राजन् पृच्छते जातशत्रवे. I think this verse we will discuss tomorrow. Now, anyway, we will just start it today. Formerly, now Sukadeva Goswami is, after explaining the distinction or the difference between the conditions for and Supreme Lord to Parikshit Maharaj, he is actually quantifying, he is providing more evidence to Parikshit Maharaj by narrating to him an incident when Yudhishthir Maharaj, who is the eldest Pandava, who became the king after the war of Mahabharata, when he was performing the Rajasvaya Yajna. So he says, O king, when Yudhishthir Maharaj was performing the Rajasvaya Yajna, the great sage Narada, responding to his inquiry, recited historical facts showing how the Supreme Personality of Godhead is always impartial, even when killing demons. In this regard, he gave a vivid example. This one we will discuss tomorrow. But here, there is one point which I wanted to mention. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Samoham sarvabhuteshu name dveshyo stinapriyaha evajanti tumam bhaktya maite teshu chapyaham. So Krishna says that he is equal to everyone, samoham sarvabhuteshu. But to those, name dveshyo sthinapriyaha, there is no one whom I hate, or there is, in the sense, no one whom I very partially favor. But ye bhajanti tu mam bhaktya maite teshu chapyaham. But to that person who is actually favorably disposed to me, he is a friend to me and I am a friend to him. Maite teshu chapyaham. So because Lord is a person, so he has special interest in devotees. It's not discrimination. It's very natural, like we have discussed. Another example is given. We'll be discussing this tomorrow also. Suppose there are two electrical equipments in our home. One is a heater and another is a refrigerator. And both have wires. And when one connects both these wires to electricity, what happens? Electricity is common to both. And switching on the plug or switching on the power is also common. But what happens? One device, as the power is being supplied, it is increasingly heated. For example, the water heater or geyser in our home. When you supply electricity, over a period of time, it becomes very, very hot. And similarly, the refrigerator, taking the same electricity, it becomes very, very cool. Similarly, those who are in sattva guna and who are progressing in sattva guna, with the influence of time factor, they become more and more dear to the Supreme Lord. And those who are in Rajoguna and Tamoguna, they are annihilated. For example, when we go out of our home for a few days, we never turn off the refrigerator, because we know that even though there is continuous flow of electricity, the refrigerator is not going to damage. But we take care. In fact, we verify 3 or 4 times that the geyser is switched off. So the Lord is just a person who creates the time factor. It is like a person who turns on the plug. It is like a person who turns on the plug. When someone turns on the plug, he is just turning on the plug. How the device is behaving depends on how the device is made. And how, so therefore, how a particular person is conducting depends upon how his consciousness is and how the influence of gunas are there on him. And that again depends on the person's karma. And that again depends on the person's free will. So therefore, Lord has nothing to do why a person is more in sattvaguna or why a person is more in rajoguna or tamoguna. Just like a person who has turned on the electricity, he just turns on the electricity. That's all. If it is a geyser, it has to burn. We have to be very careful. But if it is a refrigerator, we don't need to worry. So this is the explanation. So today I am ending here. I thank all devotees for joining, and I thank all the admin team. I thank all the devotees who made this PowerPoint presentation and who are taking a lot of time to facilitate this discussion. Kranti Prabhu, Shyam Sundar Prabhu, they will also be taking many other chapters in future. Thank you all. Thank you for attending. So now we can take questions for 10 minutes or we wind up for the day.
Prabhu, we have a few questions in chat window. So I'll read out the questions.
Yeah.
So Nisarga Mata is saying, Dandavat Pranam Prabhu, as you mentioned, we have attachment towards something is favorable and hatred towards something we don't like. But as a devotee, we must be tolerant to Icha and Dvesha. Even after so much of practice, why one is not able to forgive each other easily and engage oneself in Krishna consciousness?
Yes, that's a very good question. Thank you, Mataji. Yes. We have attachment towards something favorable and we have hatred towards something which we don't like. Actually speaking, let us elaborate this. We have attachment towards something which is which actually gives pleasure to our senses. And we have hatred towards something which actually doesn't give pleasure to our senses. Or you say, we have attachment to something which actually gives pleasure to our false ego, to be very specific. Rather than senses, of course it is senses also, we have attachment towards something which actually sans our false ego. And we have hatred towards something which actually crushes our false ego. But the Supreme Lord is not like that. That is what we have been discussing so far. So our partiality is material. But the Lord's apparent partiality is not material, because even to those persons to whom it appears that Lord is not favorably disposed, he also benefits from the Lord's behavior. But when we behave, both the persons are actually not benefited, because our partiality is actually very material, very selfish partiality. Anyway, come. But as a devotee, we must be tolerant to Icha and Dvesha. Yes, definitely. After so much of practice, why one is not able to forgive each other easily? Yes, Mataji, as you said, we are still practicing devotees. One must consciously cultivate this habit of being tolerant. That is why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says in Shikshashtakam, with what consciousness one must actually chant the holy name of the Lord. Trinadapi sunichena tarorapi sahishnuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadaharihi. With what consciousness should one actually chant the holy name? One must chant with the consciousness of being lower than a blade of grass. One must think oneself to be lower than a blade of grass. Trinadapi sunichena tarorapi sahishnuna. One must be very tolerant. Yes, one must be tolerant. There are going to be many, many difficulties even after one is engaged in Krishna consciousness. We are going to face many difficulties. It may be adi adhyatmika, adi bhautika, adi devika kleshas. So like this, there may be many kleshas actually. So therefore, we must practice. It's only practice actually, as you have mentioned. We have to keep on practicing. we should be enthusiastic. Even if we fail many times. I also fail many times. We are not able to control our anger. We are not able to forgive. We have so much of ichcha and dvesha. Ichcha towards something which is gratifying my false ego. Dvesha towards something which is crushing my false ego. I am also learning. I am also still practicing. So yes, one must practice. So the best way is chant the holy name in this consciousness. Always be in a mood to serve the devotees. Serve the devotees who are chanting. Serve the devotees who are actually rendering, who are actually taking this mission forward. Serve all the devotees and daily discuss Srimad Bhagavatam in association of devotees. So these three things, of course, there are many things which others can add. Kranti Prabhu and Shamsundar Prabhu can add. This is something which came to my mind right now, but other devotees, other speakers can also add. Shamsundar Prabhu, Kranti Prabhu, you want to add?
No, Prabhu, I think that is good.
It will take time. As Andrew already mentioned, yes, it will take time. Mentioned in the chat, I have just seen the chat. So yes, out of thousands of men, one may endeavor for perfection, and out of those who have achieved perfection, one knows me in truth. Okay. How can we set our ego aside and forgive others? Again, same thing. It needs constant practice. And what is this constant practice involve? Constant practice involves constant association of devotees, constant discussion of Srimad Bhagavatam in association of devotees, and cultivating. These are all something, you know, anukulyena krishnanushilanam bhaktiruttam anyabhilashita shunyam jnana karma vinavritam anukulyena krishnanushilanam anushilanam means one must consciously practice this. It doesn't come in a day. It may take years and years, maybe even many lifetimes. We don't know, depending on our previous habits, as Kranti Prabhu mentioned. It will take time, but one must be tolerant. One must tolerate one's own shortcomings also. One must know that one is in the right path. When I'm engaged in devotional service, when I'm engaged in hearing and chanting about the Lord, when I'm constantly associating with the devotee, I may not be perfect, definitely. But the path and process is perfect. So one day, if I keep on doing this, in a humble and honest way, definitely Krishna is going to help me. Okay. Next. Prabhu, you say that God is present in everybody. Then why Rakshasas, demons behave badly? Yes, Lord is present in everybody. That is Lord's mercy. And when the Rakshasas or the people or the persons who are having this demonic mentality, their bad behavior is because of their misuse of free will. That's all. Because of the misuse of free will, we have come here to this material world, and different living entities have misused their free will in different ways and have been misusing their free will in different ways. Even after getting a human body, say for example, we are all in this material world because whoever is in this material world, whether it be an animal or whether it be, a bird or whether it be a human being, all of us are here because we have misused our free will. Yes, but even in those who misuse their free will, there are different grades, right? There are some people who are in the higher planets, and there are human beings like us, and there are birds and beasts. Lord is present in everyone. But yes, they behave badly because of the misuse of their free will. Lord is present, but if they want to misuse their free will, what can Lord do? See, for example, there is a child, there is a father. The child is very affectionate. Sorry, the father is very affectionate to the child. But the child may be rebellious. Father will never want the child to behave improperly. But the child may or may not behave properly. But that doesn't mean the Lord is not with the child, right? It is about one's free will, that's all. I hope it answers your question.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes. So even we all have a free will. For example, we all are taking time. We are all taking some time to attend this session. Lord is present in all of us. If someone chooses not to attend, or if someone chooses not to take to this path, then who can stop us? Lord will give an indication. To the extent we become sincere, he will give some indication. For example, sometimes even though we are very regularly doing our devotional activities, a very sincere person, he also may be struggling sometime and he might want to avoid certain things for some time, but then Lord will help that person. But if somebody is not ready to use his free will properly, then he has to face, then slowly he will come to know, understand. Okay, three new messages. Very good question. Teja Prabhu, thank you very much. Difference between ego and false ego. Very nice. Yes, Kranti Prabhu has already given the answer. Real ego is the consciousness that one is the eternal servant of the Supreme Lord. Yes, false ego is characterized by mentality of being the doer. Prabhu, we have to use everything we have in Krishna's service. Then how can we use our anger, ego and jealousy in his service? Yes. Firstly, it's a good question actually. We can use our anger by becoming angry towards those people who are... Generally, why do we become angry? We become angry when somebody hurts our false ego or when someone causes some harm to us, right? We become jealous of such a person. We become angry. But to use this anger properly, one must actually be advanced in devotional service. Until then, it is better we control our anger. Even if we become angry at someone, we really don't know what is our position. Our position is very insignificant. What is our position can be ascertained. Only Lord knows. And someone who is more advanced than us, who is actually guiding us on this path, even they know. So better we take their guidance instead of whimsically using our anger. We may think, I am getting angry because he is offending the Lord, but we ourselves don't know our position. So better we control our anger because we are still in the practicing stage. We control all these anarthas. Then as we get purified, Lord will give intelligence how to use our anger properly. So right now, when we are in the practicing stage, better we keep aside our anger, ego and jealousy. Does that clarify, Mataji?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Prabhuji, I have a question. So as we discussed, Lord is not partial to anyone. He treats everyone equally. So why there is a difference between devotees and the people who are full of compassion and humility who are serving normal people?
No, I didn't hear you properly. Can you please repeat your question?
Yeah, Prabhuji, as Lord is not partial to anyone, he treats everyone equally, then why there is a difference between the devotees and the normal people who believe in humanity and they serve people? They don't go in the bhakti marg and all. They will serve people. They will contribute in serving. They will run NGOs and all. They will help the needy people. They are full of compassion. They don't have any attachment. Why there is a difference?
Actually, let me repeat your question. Your question is that why is there, when the Lord is equal to everyone, why is there a difference between devotees and those people who are actually not taking to the path of devotional service, but who are very pious and who do a lot of social welfare and all. Is that?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah, see, there are different levels of service. Serving people, serving the compassionate, serving the needy in a selfless way. Definitely that is also a service. There is no doubt about that. So they are going to be benefited in different ways. But the devotee, what is the difference between a devotee's activities or a devotee's service and a person who renders social service? I will tell you. For example, have you seen a plant? A growing yes. plant or a creeper?
Yes.
If you have seen a growing plant or a creeper, then there are two things you can do. Either you can take water and put it on every leaf of the plant. Okay? Or you can water the root of the plant. What is the intelligent way? How will the plant actually be nourished?
Watering the root of the plant.
Yes. When you water the root, automatically everything will be nourished. Right?
Yes.
Automatically everything will be nourished. Similarly, when you want the whole body to be nourished, what do? You take the food and you put it in your mouth, right? When you put the food in your mouth, automatically the whole body is nourished. You don't need to put the food separately in different parts of the body, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Similarly, those who are engaged in devotional service, they are actually engaged in the highest dharma. Savai pumsham paro dharmo yatho bhakti radokshaje ahaituki apratihata yenatma suprasidati. This is an explanation given by Suta Goswami in response to the question asked by the sages of Naimisharanya. You will see it in the first canto. Savai pumsham paro dharmo. The sages ask, what is the best dharma in Kali Yuga? So, Suta Goswami, wherein Bhagavatam was recited at one point of time. So then Suta Goswami replies saying that, what is the parodharma? Parodharma means the highest dharma. Save pumsham parodharma yato bhakti radokshaje. That is, devotional service to the Supreme Lord is the highest dharma. What the other people are doing is also one level of dharma, and definitely they will be rewarded for that. But a person who is performing devotional service to the Lord, he is actually pouring water at the root. So he is going to slowly revive his constitutional position. See, whoever the person may be, he is a part and parcel of the Supreme Lord, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he is an eternal servant of the Supreme Lord, right? One person is rendering devotional service to the Lord, so he very quickly regains his consciousness. He very quickly is reinstated in his original position. And if he is purified, he will go back to Godhead in this very lifetime. And similarly, the other person, he may take time. What he is doing is not wrong. The social service, it is not wrong. But it is not the highest dharma. See, you are feeding poor people, for example. How long can you feed them? You feed him one time, right? Within 3 or 4 hours, he will become hungry again. Again you feed him. Again he will become hungry. Right? So what is the highest dharma? The highest dharma is to do something permanent for that person. Right? Whatever you are doing. See, when a tsunami comes, they build houses and give. But when another tsunami comes, that is going to go. Right? Is it an eternal benefit which you are doing? No. Then what is the eternal benefit? Somebody who shows you the eternal path is your eternal benefactor. Are you getting me?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Someone who shows you the eternal path. For example, if a child is lost in an exhibition or in a very crowded place, there may be one person who is very compassionate to the child, but he doesn't know who is the child's father. So what he does, he takes the child, he takes him to the police station, and you know, he gives him some biscuit, he gives him some, you know, ice cream and all these things. This may temporarily calm down the child, but there may be another person who sees the child and he says, oh, I know his father. So what is the eternal benefit you can do to the child? To take him back to his father, right?
Yeah.
Although yes, the other person is also compassionate, but still his action or his service is temporary to the child. Because if you give a child ice cream, he may be quiet for 10 minutes. Again, he's going to cry. Mummy, daddy is going to cry, right? Amma, nana is going to cry. But if you actually take him to his father, then that is his permanent benefit. This is just an analogy. I hope you're understanding. So similarly, social service, you are feeding people, it is good. It is definitely selfless. It is much better than being selfish. But there is something much higher than that. And who is the highest benefactor? That person who actually shows you the spiritual path, who shows you what is your constitutional position, who shows that you are a eternal servant of the Supreme Lord. Supreme Lord is your eternal father who helps you in reviving your relation with the Supreme Lord. The service done by that person is the highest service.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Does that clarify?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Okay, thank you. Shall we close today?
Yes,
are there any more questions someone wants?
We have a couple, Prabhu, but still we will post it in the group. So I think we should be good for today based on the time constraint.
One question is there. I think, what is spiritual potency through which Lord is acting like a conditioned tool? Yeah, it is Lord's mercy. Thank you for the question. We will see it in the future verses also. why Lord behaves, I mean, why Lord, you know, acts like a conditioned soul? It is his mercy to attract the conditioned soul. Thank you, Mataji. But we will see in the next question. How can we stop judging other people? Yeah, I think we can take these questions subsequently also. How to stop judging other people is, we should just practice it, that's all. We should understand that we are all fallen. One person may be committing one mistake, but I also have many mistakes. So we should start looking at our own mistakes and at our own fallen position. Then we will not have time to judge others. Does that answer your question, Mataji? Hare Krishna. What is the difference between Asura and Rakshasa? Yeah, Asura is a person who is actually inimical towards the Lord. And yeah, Rakshasa and Asura is almost used synonymously only. Thank you. They say Manava Seve, Madhava Seva. We will see in the future. Today we have crossed time. Our limit is 6:45 only. So Mataji, you can ask it in the future sessions also. Manava Seve, Madhava Seva, you have asked it, but we are running out of time, Mataji. We can discuss it offline or you can clarify it with Anuradha Mataji. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prabhu.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna.